Welcome to Grit Happens. I'm Mindy Stearns, and to know him is to love him. He is a CEO, an entrepreneur, an outlier, an overcomer, a father, a brother, an underdog. I'm talking about my husband, Glenn Stearns, and this is Grit Happens. How do you like that?
I think I liked it. It was a little hard there.
It was a little gritty. I know. I forgot my next line was my name.
Your name.
That was an easy one. I just...
Wow. Hey, so we have somebody very, very special. I'm very excited to talk to today.
You know, it's kind of funny. I like to call you guys twins because when you get together, it's like that movie Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Who am I, Arnold?
Oh, right. Yeah. Please welcome the champ, the wood, the man, Mr. John Elway.
Hey. Glenn and Mindy, two of my favorite people. How you guys doing?
Hi, hon. Oh, my God. We love you. I love that you're on the golf course right now. Because if you couldn't be here, that would be the second best place to be.
you're right. I wish I was with you, but you're right. This isn't the second best place.
Yes.
That's right. COVID-19 isn't putting you down.
Nope.
No, sir.
Did you shoot already? Did you already?
We already played. Yeah, we played earlier. Yeah,
and
good day and playing a little tournament up here in Black Rock. It was okay. It was a practice round, so we don't want to, play too well in the practice squad. We just want to be out here and have some fun.
there you go.
It was a good start.
Oh my gosh, I love that. You love golf. I mean, you almost have to be under a rock to not know who Mr. John Elway is. We call you friend, but you know your reputation precedes you. Your world in football, your world in sports, and in all sports, not just football. You have
business.
Had such a businessman, has had a really strong career, even after your heyday in sports, and now you're managing, and you just do so much. A father, a husband, You've just been a man of so many skills and accomplishments. And, somehow we've crossed paths and through the craziness have become such great friends and gotten to know you so well. And you and Glenn have such a special relationship. I like to, brag about the two of you together because there's something that happens when you two sit down and start talking. And there's like a kindred spirit there.
You know what? Go ahead.
There really is, Mindy, and I think that, it's interesting to try to figure out exactly why that is, but I think that there's so much that we have in common, but we don't have a lot of things in common because our backgrounds, where we came from, and it's a great relationship that we do have, and like you said, Mindy, it's always so fun to get around and spend time with Glenn because it's such a different perspective and a great perspective.
And I thought it was because you also knew I didn't even have one football question to ever ask you.
And the thing is, I did not have to explain football and why I did something to you. So that was a good reason.
Exactly.
Glenn is never, ever, as long as I've known him, he's never been a football couch, watching games.
I like it, but I don't.
No, but unless it was like the Super Bowl, we'd like to go to games, but you're just never, you don't know any. There's some funny stories about how little Glenn knows about football.
I'm one of his friends that doesn't call and go, you got to fire that guy. He's just horrible. Did you see what happened? He was, I don't do that. So
we never have to talk about football. That's the best thing. I think what I like about it. And that's why I think our conversations are so great. And, it's always a great learning experience for me to be able to learn, Glenn's background as well as yours, Mindy, and what you guys have been doing, but also, just the different paths that we took to get where we are right now. And I think that's a tremendous
feeling
for me and why.
That's what I do want to talk about is, I got a couple of things that I think we'll dive into regarding our friendship. But, what I know I've always been curious about, and I think everybody out there is that with anybody, what I've always been curious about in not just with John, but with anybody that's done something that is
remarkable, out of the ordinary,
right? Is how did they do it, and what did they have special that other people just don't have, and that sets them apart, right? And so, I've always been fascinated with that type of of accomplishment in somebody. And so you've had many, many different things that you've done along the way that I've been fascinated by. But we've had many a time where we have gotten to sit late night, maybe had a final.
And time for a final.
And I would just dig in there. And yeah, maybe they were some football questions, but
it was more about the process of what was going on.
Yeah, I want to know what's in your head, right? An example, and I want you to say, John, because I've asked you these kind of questions, is, you know, you're in a game, you get tackled, and you're getting sacked over and over again. What do you do? What do you say to your team when you go back to a huddle after you've just been pounded on a few times?
He loves to ask.
Well, you know, we've had this conversation before, and there's been times that I say, you know, look at the offensive line. I said, okay, did I piss you guys off? Because they are killing me. So just tell me what I did wrong. I'm sorry. I'll, you know, please forgive me if I said anything that made you mad, but they are absolutely killing me right now. So if you could help me out a little bit, we'll eventually dig out of the hole that we've created. But I'm sorry if I've offended any of you guys.
Exactly.
And it's a good approach.
So that usually, at least that, you know what that did? It lightened the load a little bit and, you know, hopefully got us going a little bit, a couple times anyway.
And, you know, and that's exactly, you know, it's because of, you know, in a great leader, I asked that because I say, like, do you motivate them by yelling at them? And I don't think that really works a lot of time. And in your case, you're saying you use humor. They already knew what they did. They knew that they let a guy by. They knew the things that they're doing that aren't helping the team go forward. So to your point, why rub it in? Right.
Yeah. Well, you know what, Glenn, there are so many different leadership comes in so many different forms. You know, there's guys that want to yell and scream and hard and, you know, intimidate and do those type things. You know, I was more of a leader that, hey, listen, I'm in the same boat. We're all in the same boat at all times. I was one that always wanted to do as much, if not more, than anybody had done. And that way they could never say as a quarterback that, you know, I was treated any special. I always wanted to be the guy that led them by doing everything and more. So they could never say that, you know what, when I asked them and I needed them in certain situations that, you know, they never doubted the fact that I hadn't put in my time too.
Right.
So, you know, it's interesting. We talk about leadership and there's so many different forms of leadership and it's how you approach it. And there's several very, you know, effective ways to lead. But I think that, you know, the bottom line in leadership comes with respect and people have to respect the people that are doing the leading.
Amen. And I think you can call it servant leadership. You can call it what you like. But I think when you're the one that says nothing is beneath me and you put that example out there, then everybody else steps up their game. And that's, and you go back to that first thing you were saying is, you know, we had so much in common, yet we were so different. But what we really have in common is, you know, the way I think we both treat people, the way we respect the people that we've had around us. And it obviously showed, I mean, you know, you built a heck of a football team, mm-hmm. and then the move on past that. Now, tell me about what in your career, right? You march along, and you end up having, was it 3 or 4 failed Super Bowl attempts, right? It was three. Okay,
but no one's counting. Who's counting?
Sorry.
Thank God.
Exactly.
I don't want you to add an extra one on there.
No, sorry.
Please
sorry.
Don't add any more.
But like, you know, the longevity, like it's kind of like you can take a game and you can look at it, or you can take your career and look at it, because it all happened the same way as far as I'm concerned, which is you were, I think, the most comebacks ever in football history, I think belongs to you. And what is it about you? And then you look at your career, right? And you had failed at Super Bowl, and then in the last 2 Super Bowls you win. It's exactly the same thing. You come back in the end all the time. And I'm fascinated with that, John, again, is because most people don't want the ball at the end, right? They're like scared. Everyone's looking at them. What's going to happen? What is it about you that you wanted
you
that ball?
You run into the fire. You don't run away from it.
Well, you know, because the bottom line, and it's really simple. I mean, it sounds like it may be very complicated, but the bottom line is I wanted the ball because I wanted to have the ball a chance to win. Because if we didn't have the ball, we don't have a chance to win. And so I always looked at it saying, hey, listen, if we don't do something right now, we're going to lose this football game. So time is running out. It wasn't the fact that I looked at the end and say, if we don't, you know what? If we don't go down and make these great plays, we're going to lose. I looked at it and said, hey, this is our last chance. We've got to figure out a way to get something done, figure out a way to put a drive together, get this thing in the end zone or get a field goal, whatever we needed. And so it wasn't a fact that we were afraid about it. I was more afraid of the fact if we didn't do something, then we were going to lose a football game. And what happened was that became we became more confident. The more we did it, when we ran on the football field, when we needed to make plays, when you need to get things done, the whole 11 guys on the offensive side believed that we could get it done because we'd done it. And so that kind of just snowballed to where every time, if we're having a tough day, things weren't working out well, that we always knew we kept working our tails off to figure out how to get something done. And then when it came down to the end, it's like, boys, we're out of time, that we got to make something happen here, and we're able to get it done. So I don't know the exact answer other than the fact that I was never scared of that situation. I just didn't like the outcome if we did get something done, which was we'd lose a football game.
But I'd say so many people want that same outcome.
They want the outcome. They just aren't willing to
figure out how to motivate the 11 guys to get it there, you know? And so that's what's special. Again, that's what's the different part. And, you know, again, we've had so many long nights where I've literally tried to just analyze everything about those details because I enjoy the details, you know?
And there's something about the both of you. I noticed that there's a tenacity that exists within you that is a never give up, go to the end. And a lot of people abandon that in the final moments. And is there something you feel was instilled? Did your dad instill that? Do you feel you were born with that? Or is that something that people can nurture within themselves? Is it when you get to that final moment, are you just born with it?
I will say this. It was hard for me. It was harder playing with a lead than it was being behind. Because when you're playing with a lead, all you have was bad things could happen.
Right.
Yeah.
And so because now you're leading, so you make a mistake, now you lose the game. That was much worse. So that was much harder for me to play with a lead than it was to play coming from behind. Because if we didn't do anything coming from behind, we were already going to lose.
Right.
So that was my mindset. I was never afraid of if we weren't on the field with 3 minutes to go, we needed a touchdown or we needed a field goal. That was when I got fired up because I'm going, I don't like the result right now. And if we don't do something right now, then we're going to lose the football game. Now, how did that articulate itself in my mind?
Right.
I don't know. Other than the fact that I knew I didn't want to lose.
Well, that's a strong drive. And I think you and Glenn have that.
Right. Right. And I think that's, you know, when we sit there and talk about the thing, the conversations, the talking that we've done, the different things that Glenn's done that no one else has done that's made him where you got him and both you where he is today. And the fact that, you know what, you do the extra thing and you don't take no for an answer. And, you know, it's easy to run on the field and say, okay, well, we can't win this football game. But it's like, instead of saying, yeah, we don't have a chance, it's saying, we're going to figure out a way to get this done.
Yeah.
And that to me is what makes the difference between very, very successful people because, and average people is because it's easy. When things are good, that's easy.
Yeah.
When things are tough, that's when it's hard. And that's when it's hard to figure out a way to get things figured out. And I think that that's what made me, and the harder it got, the better I got because I'm like going, no one's going to tell me I can't do something because the harder it gets, the more they're going to tell you can't do it.
Yeah.
And the more they told me I couldn't do it, the harder I tried to make it to prove them wrong. And so I was motivated by the negative aspect of what was going on when people told me I couldn't do something.
Did people tell you that you couldn't open a restaurant or open a car dealership or did you? Because here you go after you get off the field.
Yeah. Well, I tell you what, when I went into the car business, my dad was like going, what are you doing? Da 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 da. And I said, you know what? I figured at that point in time, that was 1989, so I'd been in the league for 7 years, and I really wanted to have something that when I retired from football that I could transition into, because I didn't want to be left flat out doing, you know, trying to figure out once I got done with football,
right,
what am I going to do? So I wanted to make sure that I did something to kind of bridge that gap. And the car business was one of them. And my dad was shaking his head when I said, all right, Dad, I'm going to get in the car business. I'm going to learn it, work at it in the off season, get good at it and try to be the best I can. Wow. And the bottom line is, the thing about being successful in any business is having good people around you and smart people around you that know, yep, more than you know, because that's rule. How you learn.
Amen.
And
I mean, you. So, and speaking of winning, you've won some Super Bowls as a quarterback and you've won them as a manager. Which win feels more sweet?
You know, as a player, it was more of an accomplishment because that's what I'd done my whole life.
Yeah.
That's the goal I wanted my whole life, was to be able to win a Super Bowl. That's why that day was the greatest day of my life, other than my kids being born.
Aww.
You know, the feeling of accomplishment was the greatest feeling of all time. And so it was, and then to be able to come back and win it the next year is just as gratifying. Yeah. But then as a manager, when I became the GM and trying to put a team together for me to be able to use all my expertise as far as what I liked in coaches, what kind of system I liked, what I liked in players, what kind of players I liked, and how to put the whole team together. And then to be able to do that and win Super Bowl 50 was very satisfying. Oh. To be able to get, I was happy for the players and the coaches, and for me to be able to say, you know what, I was able to use my experience of what I've been through in losing Super Bowls, of what we need to have, you know, why did we lose those Super Bowls and what was the difference in the losing Super Bowls compared to the winning Super Bowls.
Yeah.
And to be able to have that knowledge, to me, made me a much better manager, a general manager. So, and then to be able to finally get over that hump. Yeah. It was a great feeling. It was great to be able to do it for Pat Bowen, who was a great owner, played for him, and all he wanted to do was win and be able to say, hey, you know, because my first Super Bowl win, he said, this one's for John, and for me to be able to say,
so beautiful.
This one's for Pat. This one's
great.
For Pat was, yeah, it was very, the most special time I've had in my life.
So is it, how does it feel when you don't have the control of the ball, though? I mean, it must be a different feeling when you really are, you know, you're not the coach, right? I mean, you're responsible way above that, and now you can't get out there and really even tell these guys what to do.
I know. It took me a while to get used to that. You know, I started,
I bet.
And the thing is, so we get back to the car business. I, got in the car business. I had 6 dealerships. In 1998, they came in and offered me a lot of money for my dealerships. I said, okay, you're going to have the dealerships. Now I'm going, because that's what I was going to do when I was retired. Now I'm going, okay, now what am I going to do? Decide to get into the Arena Football League. And it was that was the best learning experience I've ever had. Even though the Arena League was, not well known by anybody or whatnot, but it was a great MBA for me to be able to be in that situation. Gave me the experience. We won a championship. We were 1-2-14 our first year. We won a championship in the third year, and then I continued that for 3 years before I went with the Broncos. But that experience I had in the Arena League tremendously helped me tremendously with the Broncos. And so that experience of being able to take yourself and say, okay, my ego's not too big to do anything. I just want to know that I didn't want to be a coach in football, but I did eventually want to be in the management side. And the Arena Football League was that chance for me to be able to do that. So I swallowed my pride, went to the Arena Football League for six years. Uh-huh. And even though it wasn't a very expensive
you
NBA.
And Bon Jovi.
Bon Jovi.
Bon Jovi, exactly.
Both of you living on a prayer.
That's right. But that was a great learning experience for me to be able to say, okay, I'm gonna go learn it that way. So when I did step in with the Broncos, that I had that experience, and that was invaluable to me.
Yep.
Hey, so I know that I just wanted to mention that I know that it was really happy moment when Glenn won. I mean, when John won as a manager, and I think there might even be a video out there of just how happy you were with Glenn and a little bromance that erupted in the hotel.
Say,
oh my God.
Going on.
We'll be going back to Walmart. That
is freaking.
Oh, yeah. So are you glad you got off the board?
No, go back out on this balcony.
Is there a party that wishes you'd like to shout out that balcony?
Let the boys be boys.
No, you know, I was coaching John along
boys
the way.
Boys will always be boys.
Yes,
and
you will.
I was very happy.
Jumping on the beds.
I should have gotten my own ring because I was very involved in that entire year. But that's okay. I am not bitter.
Well, at least there is a photo where he let you borrow or at least wear all the rings.
I think
There you go. Lots and lots and lots of rings.
You know, when we were hunting and we came back and his son said, Dad, what's this? He pulls out a ring. Oh, it's one of my championship. And he pulled another and another and another. And I said, can I wear those? And I didn't have enough fingers. You know, I'm like, holy crap. You know, it was crazy. Hey, so, all right, I've got a question for you. So a lot of people want to know at least I do, right, which is the details. Now, you've been involved in at least two of the most famous plays of all time in football, right? One, obviously, when you were in college, had to do a little band.
Yes.
Right? And then the other one called The Drive, right?
Uh-huh.
So just take a minute, if you don't mind, walk us through what's going on in John's head in the middle of The Drive.
You know, I will say this, Glenn. It was, we were backed up on our 2-yard line. There was 5 minutes to go. We're playing in Cleveland Municipal, an old time stadium. I remember looking at the old TV shows of Jim Brown and the old Cleveland Browns playing in that stadium. And so it was one of those kind of days in Cleveland. And they were a great football team. They had a great defense, and we'd struggled the whole day. And so when we got out there, it was a TV timeout, and it was a baseball field too. So there was a big group behind us that was there, a big area behind us. So we're sitting there waiting for the TV timeout, and our right guard, whose name is Keith Bishop, who is a tremendous friend of mine and is now our director of security for the Broncos. He said, boys, looked around because everybody was kind of like not talking or saying anything. And he says, boys, we got him right where we want him. And he finally got, he loosened everybody up. But from that point on, what we really did is we just started thinking about getting first down. We wanted to get some room behind us because we're on the 2-yard line. So I threw a pass in the flat. We picked up 5. We ran the ball a couple times. And then as time went on, we started picking up momentum. And as we picked up momentum, the crowd got quieter and quieter and quieter. But you know what, Glenn, I will say this. I can't tell you that the fact is of anything I was thinking outside of what I was doing. And there was nothing that, okay, if we do this, we get to here, we get it. It was just one play at a time, one step at a time. And it was just a methodical. And the thing is, the great thing is we could feel the momentum. We didn't have to talk about it. It just kept going. We kept playing better and better, right? And so then eventually we get in, we scored the touchdown. Now, on top of that, we still have to go to overtime. And, made another good drive in overtime to be able to kick the field goal to win it. So, and that was in my 4th year. That was kind of my coming out game.
Yeah.
And it was really kind of put me on the map, especially after what I did, coming out as the first pick in the draft, saying it would go to Baltimore and upsetting kind of the apple cart.
Well, we still see the license plate. Mindy had the one, Hate Elway. We laugh.
Oh, yeah.
They're mad at you still, John.
I know. And the thing is, Glenn, you're from Baltimore, too.
I know.
I know. Isn't that irony?
Hey, so I know everyone is yelling at me going, there wasn't two, Glenn. There were 3 great plays, and the other play was the helicopter, right?
Yeah.
And now that has a very special meaning for me. But I want you to, if you don't mind, again, because this is why
this is the grit that happened
2 a.m. Yeah. Right. So tell me what's in your head then.
Well, so it's like 3rd and 6, or third. Yeah, it's like 3rd and 5 or 6. We're on like the 11 or 12 yard line, and so. We'd had this play the week prior to the game. We had this play, and Mike Shannon, who was the best quarterback or best coach I ever played for, was our head coach for the two Super Bowls that we won. He was also my quarterback coach, as well as an offensive coordinator throughout my career. So tremendous coach. But so we're in the Super Bowl, and he comes up and he goes, John, I got this place. We put it in this net. He goes, against this formation in this situation, it's 100% of the time we'll get this coverage. And so we run it in practice. And I'm like, you know, Mike, I really don't like this play a lot. You know, and he was usually pretty good listening to me. And we always had, you know, we're really good friends. And so we'd go back and forth. And he goes, but I don't like it. He goes, John, it's 100% of the time we get this coverage against this formation in this situation. I said, well, okay. So sure enough, 3rd and 6, here comes the play. And it was, the corner was bumped, safety was off. And so it was looked before the game, before the play even went off. And I look out there, and I don't have, it's the 1 in 101 time.
Oh, no, gosh.
It was a total different defense. So I'm going, okay. So it's 3rd and 6. So I said, okay, well, I'm going to drop back, and I got to get outside. Hopefully we can make something happen and give some, you know, receivers some time to get open, and maybe I can make a play on the outside. And so I got outside. They stayed deep, and I took off, and I looked at the first down marker, and so I said, okay, I'm going to take off. And I said, okay, there's 3 Green Bay Packers coming at me. And Glenn, I actually got this. I got the bronze for you that's up this play.
I was going to say that. That's right.
Yeah.
This bronze.
This is the one I said, okay, well, here they come. And I'm going, well, they think I'm going to go low. So I decided I'm going to put the big old 3-inch or the 6-inch vertical jump, and I'm going to go right over the
table. 6-inch vertical.
When they go low, you go high.
Went over the top and just end up spinning around. I will tell you this, and yeah, I've told you this, is I can still feel the
the impact.
My heart just that too. It hurt my rib, but I looked to our sideline, and the whole sideline was just going, and it was just like. The emotions of that and that feeling of it, I still get goosebumps when I think about
that's
it.
That's a goosey one, huh?
Hey,
that's
see, a goosey. Oh, yeah. And that's a leader, you know, and that happens to be one of my more profound moments, because you got a bronze. I think they made 2 of them for you, and you gave your second one to me.
That makes Glenn so proud.
It really does make me proud, and it's not about you as a football man, it's about you as a friend. And I really have that on my desk at home, and
take a lot of pride in that.
Yeah, it means a lot to me, John.
Oh, that's awesome.
You know, we've had a lot of fun.
And, oh,
you know,
we've traveled. We've
about Playboy
had lots of final
mansion
finals
stories, and we could talk about
breaking
things
into the Playboy mansion.
We won't go there. I was just saying but there's a couple things that stick out to me, and about friendship, right? And this is what, again, I think makes you different, right? Like, you know, we'll go places, and you know, people want John's autograph or people want John's picture, and he's always very, very kind.
Gracious.
Exactly. But it must be a little difficult to, you know, always have people asking and wanting and stuff, right? And so, you know, we've been able to be with you in places where I remember one time we had, someone very famous. We were on our boat, and someone very, very famous that wanted to come see you. And he says, why don't you come up? And I don't remember his name. It doesn't matter. But you said, well, why do I want to go see him when I've got you guys right here? Let's just sit here and continue talking about what we're talking. I said, he just blew off this crazy famous guy just to sit with a bunch of nobodies and sit and have a beer. And then I remember the time that you said that actually I think it was Prince Albert that had invited you to, and I'm wearing the hat,
Prince
Celebration
Ryder Cup, yep.
That yes. He asked you to go to an event. And you said, I'm only going if I can take my
caddy. My own caddy who's never caddied before.
That's right.
Well, yeah, but I will tell you this, is that, Glenn, you were the all-star there. I mean, with what you went through, but you toughed it out, and we went out there and played, and we had, you know what, It was awesome just having you there. But you were the all-star being there for, you know, going through with, you know, the
six just had surgery. You tried to say no. You guys tried.
I tried to say no.
Yes,
well,
you did.
That was my point.
They tried.
That was a true friend. But, Glenn, I will say this is that, you know, when you talk about people that people know, the bottom line is the way I look at me is God gave me a God-given ability to play football. And, you know, he gave me some intelligence to where, and he gave me great parents that taught me the right things, right and wrong, and how to do things, but also gave me the gifts to be able to play football as well as, understand and know people and how to treat people. And so I look at my deal as I'm not any better than, a garbage truck driver that's the best at what he wants to do. The only thing I did was it's on TV. And that's really the difference.
Yeah.
And I enjoy people that work their tail off, whether it be, a caddy on a golf course or a server in a restaurant or a salesman in the car dealerships. They are just as special as me because they work their tail off. They're good at what they do and they take it and it means a lot to them. And so that's why I'm saying people that are talented, the only thing is in this world, things get ranked because if it's on TV or not, then all of a sudden people think you're more special and you're not. I'm not any more special than anybody else. I just did the best I could with the talent that God gave me.
No, and I agree with that. But, here's Prince Albert. He wants you to play golf. I'm thinking that's pretty darn cool. And you go, my caddy is down. I had a little cancer and I was, and so if the caddy isn't going, I'm not going. And I was like, John, you're going. You're like, no.
Gunn was like, you are not going to say no. And I am coming.
We're going. But that's kind of cool. I'd go play golf with Prince Albert. But instead, you weren't going. I had to get my butt off the hospital gurney and go with
but
you.
But you tried to keep him home, Glenn. Paige and John were like, Glenn, you need to stay home. I'm not going. You called.
I
lost your range finder.
You get healthy.
He was so doped up on morphine. Thank God you didn't ask him to lay a shot.
Hey, Mindy, it was so unbelievable. And this guy.
I lost everything that day.
I mean,
it's the worst caddy ever.
Let him talk.
I'm just telling you, I played with a lot of football players that aren't nearly as tough as Glenn Stearns.
No, that's
95% of them are not as tough as you, Glenn. And that's where, that's what's made you successful.
I was a horrible caddy.
You're the same way that you guys are tremendous and what you do for people and the enthusiasm that you go about with life and everything. It's just, it's tremendous to be able to call you my friend.
Oh,
hey,
that's so
love you, my
sweet.
Friend.
And he even tried to feed you through the feeding tube. Remember that?
Yeah. He fed me a cocktail.
Little martini.
We're gonna have a martini together.
Yeah, exactly. But you know what I dislike is how my wife will always seem to put me in a picture with you and some other big tall guy.
Sorry, it's just so funny. I can't help it.
I know
it got you in trouble once.
You know what? You're still my favorite male twin because I was my sister's a twin, but you're still my favorite male.
Rest her soul.
I mean. If it hasn't been you and who was it? What's the name of the
who?
Who was your old
Peyton Manning? Peyton Manning. You and Peyton Manning. You and Tony Romo.
It's always been like I'm the V. I'm the in the
you're
middle.
You're the V. He's the bottom of the V. Yeah. The valley. He's the valley in the V. Poor Glenn.
You know, one of the best moments, and we're wrapping up here, John, but was when we went to an event in Washington, and we were coming out of it, and it was very crowded, and. And the police officer was trying to get you out of there. And
hailed a cab.
Hailed a cab.
He's like, he got you in a cab. He threw you in the back seat. 100,000
people in there. And you get in the back seat and you sit there. And Mindy gets in the middle and your wife gets on the other end. Well, I get in the front and I see this guy's a Pittsburgh Steelers fan because he's got the coat on. Quick, top three quarterbacks of all time. Of course, I know he's going to name, everybody,
Roethlisberger,
everybody,
Steeler.
And he says, number one, gotta be John Elway. I went, what? And that was so great.
That's when we knew he didn't know you were in the back seat. That was the best.
He had no idea you were there.
You made his day. You made his day, and you took out.
Would you know John Elway if you saw him?
Elway, I would have Elway.
And if you ran into him, would you know who he was?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Do me a favor.
Why don't you
look
turn around?
Right there.
Turn around.
How you doing, man?
Oh come on, man. You serious? Come on, man. John Elway.
How you doing, girl?
Damn. Man, I gotta take a picture, man. Seriously. I'm serious. When we get out, can we take a picture together, man?
Absolutely.
You gotta take your shades off.
You got it.
You got it. Damn, that's John. I know what John Elway look like.
So you wouldn't sleep with him.
You said you sleep with him, I think.
Hell no. Hell no. Hell no. Come on, man.
You got it.
Damn.
Hey, number one, John Elway. That was good. You said that.
I gotta take some pictures, man.
Picture and
that was great.
That was so fun.
I've been very, very fortunate in my life, and very fortunate to have friends like you guys. But you know, and I think that you know what you're doing with your podcast and everything that you do for people with everything you've done is absolutely tremendous.
Oh, look at John.
Like I said, it's tremendous to be able to call you two my friends.
Well, honey, happy birthday. I know this is a big birthday year. I'm really sad that your birthday didn't quite, party didn't happen, but we're going to celebrate.
But you know what, though? That tells us we got to make sure 61, 62, 63, all those are even better.
They're going to power.
Make sure that we
were on our way.
Finals.
That's right.
Hey. I know, but those finals are getting earlier in the night.
I know they are.
Isn't that the truth?
Oh, thank you, John.
I love you.
I'm not nearly as tough as I used to be in the morning, that's for sure.
But you're as good once as – what was the saying? I'm not as good as I once was.
I'm as good once as I ever was.
As I always was.
Something like that.
Thanks, John. We love you. Love to Paige.
Will do. Love you guys.
Love you too.
We'll talk to you soon.
Take care.
And, really
bye-bye.
Fun. Bye, hon.
All right, bye-bye.
Take care.
That is just great. What a fun conversation.
No, I've really enjoyed the time we've spent together. It's been real special, you know.
Yeah, John's a good guy. Good family. Good family man. And, you know, you've always attracted really good people in your life. me being one of them. But, you know, it's just good people attract good people. And, John's good people.
He's a good egg, and I'm glad what we got to do, because I really, for all of our listeners, I wanted to share those, you know, we get to hear about people being special in all kinds of different ways, but when you really get to dig into what makes them special, that's what fascinates me. And so I'm glad we got to share some of that with the listeners. So
yeah. So awesome. Thank you for joining us for another episode. You can catch us on Facebook and YouTube and Instagram for Glenn Stearns with two N's, and Grit Happens. A new episode drops every Wednesday, 2 p.m. Pacific time. And this has been another very interesting episode of Say It With Me, Grit Happens.
Thank you all.